it and then we'll start this station. So yes, doctors, as I said, today's station, the session what we are going to do today is about ECG teaching, okay? And I know for a fact that many, many doctors, they are scared of this station just because academies don't teach this station properly. Some of them just, I have personal experience with Swami Academy, what they did was we were given a video recording of Dr. Swami teaching the ECG, and that recording was a couple of years ago, okay? Probably early 2000. And it was 2 to 3 hours long recording, and just for one station, if you have to listen to a recording, which is 2 to 3 hours, and even after listening to that, you don't get even basics of ECG. Okay, so you know that is useless, right? It's of no use. And someone is teaching you, which is like totally out of date. All right. Now, doctors, in every station, I always tell my doctors that in every station in PLAB to exam, they're always trying to examine some of the skill that you may need to apply while you are practicing in NHS, okay? So they are always looking for some kind of skill that you will need, okay? Now in teaching stations, okay, whatever the teaching stations are there in your PLAB to exam, what are they looking for? What are the examiners looking for? They are looking for something, you know what, doctors, because academies don't tell you this. And what happens is that you focus on something different. Okay. So I'm telling you the purpose so that you can focus on something that is actually expected out of you. What is the ability in you that they are trying to check when there is any teaching station, by the way? Okay. What I mean to say by teaching station, where you are going to teach something to somebody. Okay. For example, there is a teaching ECG station. There is other teaching stations. Now, recently they started turning the examination stations into teaching stations as well. For example, knee examination station, they have turned into a teaching station. Respiratory examination station also was turned into a teaching station. So what are the skills they are looking for? They are looking for your teaching skills. How well you can teach. Okay, how well you can teach. Now, doctors, before I start the station, I just want you to keep few things. Doctors, I give slides to my doctors even during the course, but I always believe that if I don't convey the knowledge that I have, what's the purpose? You can just buy notes or just read scripts at home, isn't it? Or maybe I could just have shared the notes or my slides in the group, right? It is of no purpose if I don't share the knowledge and if I don't teach you properly, okay? So doctors, make sure when I'm teaching, I am always trying. You know, one thing that I'm always trying, that I try to consider myself at the same level as all the doctors, okay? I start from the basics. I start from the scratch, okay? So that's exactly what you have to do in this teaching station as well. Start from basics, okay? Start from the scratch, okay? Always start from the beginning, from the very basics. So in this ECG teaching station, you will start by very basic ECG, okay? You'll start, I will tell you in a minute, what do I mean by very basic ECG? So don't worry about that. But again, please keep in mind that you will teach her, they are not looking for cardiologists, they are looking for junior doctors and junior doctors who are safe junior doctors, okay? As a junior doctor, lots of the times when I'm applying for jobs, I'm looking at the, you know, the requirements, okay, or the job specifications. And most of the jobs in the UK require teaching skills, Okay, they require teaching skills. That's why they have put these stations in your PLAPTO exam where you are supposed to teach. Okay, so if you cannot, if the other person cannot understand a word, then how does that prove that you're a good teacher? So tomorrow, if you're expected to teach in NHS, okay, there will be medical students, there will be nursing students and all that you have to teach, right? So that's what they are expected out of you. And that's why you have to start with the basics and you have to start with the scratch. You have to always come at the same level as other person. Okay. Don't try to consider yourself as the level of a cardiologist who can read ECG very well. That's not what they're looking for. So we are very much mistaken by the approach that we are given in the academies. We think that they are expecting that there should be a cardiologist, okay, who can diagnose looking at an ECG. No, that's what is not required out of you in your PLAPTO exam, okay? At least for this station, not at all, okay? Okay. So doctors, first of all, after keeping that thing in your mind that I am going to teach this nurse a very basic ECG first, the basics of ECG first, then another point that is very, very, very important is that building rapport, okay? Building rapport with her. How can you teach someone if you have not built rapport with them? Now, I don't know if how many of you have already attended some of my free sessions, but I always tell doctors that any word, I make sure whatever problems I had in attending the academy, I don't let other doctors face the same thing. Not all of you might have very polished English. Some of you come, we all come from, you know, third world countries, from here and there, where English is not our first language and we don't understand. Academies tell you acknowledge and reflect. You don't understand a word. What is acknowledge and reflect? They tell you that build a rapport, okay? Have a good rapport. And you don't even understand that what does building rapport means. They only tell you that you have to build rapport, but you don't know what is building rapport means. Now, I always explain to my doctors that building rapport means asking some questions to a person so that we create a comfortable space for them, okay? So that they are, why in a teaching station you want to create a comfortable space? See, you will, if, for example, now while I'm teaching you, if I become very rude and arrogant and I don't stop and I don't let you ask questions, then will you ever be able to ask me questions, or will you ever want to feel like stopping me and clearing your doubts? No, not at all. You'll be like, she's going to judge us. She's going to be rude. She's going to be arrogant. So we are not going to stop her. So am I a good teacher then? No, I'm not. But if I, at the beginning, when I start teaching you, if I build rapport, I create a comfortable space around you, then you will be like, yes, that's fine. She will not judge us. She will not shout at us if we ask questions. Okay? So that's the whole purpose of building rapport. Now, you know what is the meaning of building rapport. Now, I will tell you that how to build rapport, okay? How can you build rapport, all right? By the way, doctors, building rapport will not only come in use in this station, it will come in use in other teaching stations and also the ethical stations. Angry patients, okay? Or the patients or the medical error patients where you have made a mistake. In all those stations, rapport is very important. So if you know how do I build rapport with somebody, your life will be easier even in those stations, doctors. Okay? Even for those stations, your life will become easier. All right? So how do you build rapport? First of all, doctors, whenever you are starting to build rapport or you want to get closer to somebody, are you going to tell them your whole title and your surname and your this name and your that name? Some of us, by the way, have, you know, 4 or 5 titles. So we have long names. Are you going to start like that? How do you talk to your friend, by the way, whom you are very comfortable with? You just tell your first name, right? Or you, if you want to make friends with somebody, how do you talk? You tell your first name, right? So doctors, I hope this point of mine will help you to remember that when I have to build rapport with somebody, I will always tell my first name and I will not use my title, which most of us have, doctor, Dr. Asia, Dr. Zeba, Dr. Amrit, okay, whatsoever. So don't use your title when you are building rapport with somebody, okay? Always say, I first name, use your first name, okay? Always remember like this, that with talking with a friend, how do I talk? I tell my first name if I will have to make friends with somebody. How do I introduce myself? So you'll introduce yourself by saying that, hello, I am Asia. Okay, I won't say that I'm Dr. Asia. I would say that, hello, I'm Asia. Okay, and then you will ask, are you Elena? Okay, because doctors, how you will say that, doctor, how would I know that she's Elena? Well, you'll have her name in the task outside. Okay, and you will also come to know whether she's a full-fledged nurse or she's a medical, she's still a nursing student. Okay, now I have got a point why I want you to notice that in the task outside the cubicle. I'll tell you in a minute. Okay, so doctors, now these two things are clear, that you will not use a title of yours, you will not use title of hers. Okay, and you will just say, you'll notice or you'll try to remember the name of the student, whether it's a nursing student or it's a nurse, you'll try to remember her name from outside. Okay, remind yourself that, yes, Dr. Asia told us this is a teaching station. So in any teaching station, I will try to remember the name of the student or the nurse, whoever it is. Okay, so you'll go inside the cubicle and you will say, yes, yes. Doctors, usually you should start station like that, that I am particularly for this station, but you should try not to show yourself as a superior person by saying that I am doctor this, I am a specialist cardiologist in this department. Okay, don't say that. Okay, you should say that I'm Asia, one of the doctors here in this department. Okay, one of the doctors working. I am one of the doctors, but don't use doctor twice. Okay, so it's preferable. I hope, Dr. Rafia, that's helpful. Okay, so then doctors, after you have asked her name as well, are you Elena? You're just confirming her name. Now don't ask her age, okay, because it is not relevant. Okay, it is not relevant now, because why I'm saying that, because you are so used to of confirming name and date of birth in other stations, you might tend to do in this station as well. So please don't do that, all right? Just ask, are you Elena? Yes, I am. Nice to meet you, Elena. Okay, nice to meet you, Elena. So you have said that. Okay, doctors, please, your voice tone, your body language will matter a lot. Now, doctors, whatever the teaching stations were previously, the previous protocol was that you were expected to handshake with a colleague, whether it's a nurse, it's a doctor, you are meeting, okay? You will teach a doctor colleague or a junior doctor or, you know, anybody like that. You would shake hands previously. But even my exam, when I did my exam end of January, even then we were told not to shake hands with anybody. So I hope that you doctors will also keep in mind, if they give you instructions to not shake hands, please do not shake hands, okay? As academies may blindly tell you that, you know, shake hands to build rapport. But make sure if you are given instructions to do something, please don't do that, okay? So now most probably in order to build rapport, you will not be doing that one action that you were expected to do previously. Okay, so don't shake hands if they ask you to not. Okay, and I'm expecting that. I'm pretty sure that they will tell you as well, because Corona at the end of the January was not so much in. All right, if they can say then, obviously they'll say now as well. Okay, so then doctors, if she is a student. Okay, if she is a student, then you will tell her that how is your study going? How is your study going and which year are you in? Okay, doctors, now please don't take me wrong and don't just ask all the questions. You just basically need at the beginning 2-3 questions maximum in order to just create a comfortable space. Doctors, one thing, please, I want to tell you for PLAPCHA exam, be yourself, please. Be yourself. Don't be scripted and don't follow people blindly. Whatever somebody is saying, the most you will use your common sense for your PLAPCHA exam, more easily you will pass this. Okay, so you always use your common sense. Okay, so when I'm saying that you will ask these questions, don't go to the exam and ask absolutely all the questions I have written here. Okay, you will ask at least 3 questions to her. Okay, 2-3 questions, that how's your study going, for example. Okay, how's your study going, are you enjoying, for example, if she is a full-fledged nurse, you can ask her, since when have you been working in this department, how's your posting going in this department, are you enjoying, so these kind of questions. Is she enjoying being here in the department? Is she enjoying working in this department? Okay. Or in case if she's a nursing student, you can ask her, how's your study going? Okay. And you can even ask that which year you are in, and then you can ask, how's your study going? All right. I hope I'll repeat myself. Please don't ask absolutely all the questions. Just 2-3 questions to make sure that you have built that comfortable space for both of you. Okay, then you will say to her that if she offer her help, that I'm always, for now, my posting is in this department. So Alina, at any time, if you have any queries, any questions about anything, you can always come and ask me. Please, or you can say that, please feel free. Please feel free. Or you can say, please don't hesitate whenever you need help regarding anything. It will be my pleasure to teach you. Okay. It will be my pleasure to teach you. Okay. Now, doctors, you can, at this point, in order to build rapport, you can do another thing. Okay. You can do another thing. When she says that, yes, doctor, when you offer her help, that I can teach you, you know, whenever you want something to learn, please don't hesitate and come and I will teach you. Then she will say, yes, doctor, I'm here to learn ECG today. And then you appreciate her. Okay. That is what will increase your interpersonal skills even more. Okay. I know building rapport at the beginning of the station will increase your interpersonal skills, but even telling her, even appreciating her that, well done, you are such a keen student, or you can say you are such a good professional that you want to always learn and you always want to polish your knowledge. Okay. So appreciate her that she is keen to learn. Okay. Anybody who's keen to learn, wouldn't you appreciate them? Appreciate them, at least for PLAPCHA exam, doctors. Please remember that you will appreciate her for, because she has that thing that she wants to learn things. She wants to, you know, she wants to do that, what you know as CPD, continued professional development. Okay. So she's keen on to learning so that she can provide better service. Okay. So she can provide better services in the hospital. All right. Okay. Now that you have appreciated her, the next step is that you will give yourself a safety umbrella. Now, why do I say that safety umbrella to this thing? Because some doctors are told that you are supposed to keep on checking on the student that whether they are understanding or not. Now, some of the doctors, I know many of my friends who overdid it. Okay, they overdid it. They taught one step, came back to the student. Then that, are you understanding? Are you okay? Do you have any question? Doctors, this question particularly, that do you have any question? Please, when you start teaching her, ask only then. And then at the end as well, you will ask that, does she have any questions? But don't keep asking, because every 5 seconds, every 10 seconds in your PLAP2 station, don't forget you have only 8 minutes. They are, you have, your time is very precious. Don't overdo anything. Okay, don't overdo anything. All right. Just give me a minute, doctors. Okay. Right. So you will give yourself now a safety umbrella so that you don't keep on telling her, you don't have to keep on telling her that if you have any question, please ask me, because you are going to tell her at the beginning. Okay. Before even you start teaching her, you are going to tell her that if there is any misunderstanding, don't say that if you don't understand anything. If you say, Dr. C, your words matter a lot. Your communication skills matter a lot in your PLAP2 exam. If you say that if you don't understand anything, please ask me again. Now, you know what you are doing by doing that? You are telling her, or you are doubting her abilities, her understanding abilities. You may even sound judgmental by saying that, that if you do not understand, ask me again. So rather, you should use a better word, which is if there is a misunderstanding, okay? If there is any misunderstanding, or there is anything unclear, or if I'm going too fast, please stop me and ask questions, okay? Please stop me and ask questions. So you have given yourself a safety umbrella, okay? I will read, okay? I will read your queries and your questions afterwards, okay? So you have given yourself a safety umbrella now so that you have don't have to keep on doing that, okay? You are saying that if there is any misunderstanding or you are unclear about anything at all, please ask me questions or please stop me during the teaching session, okay? Now, another safety umbrella, two safety umbrellas you need to give yourself, okay? Now, another safety umbrella is that you will tell, you will say that ECG is actually a vast topic. You'll say, Alina, let me tell you this, that actually ECG is a very vast topic, and I'm afraid I will not be able to finish this in just one session. Okay, I will not be able to finish it. You know, doctors, you know, most of the stations, it's very likely you will pass the, you will still pass the exam. But you know, half of your station, you might not be able to finish. Okay, so you are just saving yourself. Okay, you're saving. Even if you don't finish teaching everything, at least you have given yourself a safety umbrella by saying this, that Alina, let me tell you this, I'm afraid I will not be able to finish the whole session today because ECG is a very vast topic. So what we will do, we can rearrange another session. If we are unable to complete today, we can rearrange another session, or I can also give you some reference books and the online sources. Okay, I can give you some reference book or even some online resources so that you can study. How does that sound, Alina? Are you noticing, doctors? I'm involving Alina in the conversation, okay? I'm not just a robot. I'm not a robot prepared by the academy, cooked by academy, who is just going and vomiting knowledge in the exam. No, I'm not the robot. I am a proper doctor. I'm a safe doctor, and that's what I want to show to GMC. Okay, and I'm involving Alina at every step. Okay, I'm involving Alina at every step. I'll say, now I've finished saying those things, and I will say to Alina that, how does that sound? Does that, or you can say, does that sound like a plan, Alina? Yes, doctor, definitely. Okay, that's how she will respond. Okay, now doctors, after your introduction and after telling her about, you know, giving yourself two safety umbrellas, then your next step is checking her knowledge. Now, academies also tell you that you will check knowledge, you'll check the other person's knowledge, but they will not tell you that how do you check the knowledge. Okay, so I will tell you how do you check knowledge. You will ask her that, Elena, have you ever read ECG, by the way? Okay, or you can even ask her that, how much, Elena, may I know how much do you know? So that it's easier for me to teach you. Okay, or you can say that so that I know where to begin from. Okay, so that I know, Elena, how much do you know about ECG? So that I know that where to begin from or where to start from. Doctors, have you noticed that I am just showing to the examiner that I am very considerate. I will teach her according to her level. Okay. So doctors, even if I was teaching you in a class and we had a class, by the way, I don't keep more than 15 doctors in my, last time there became like 17, 18 doctors, but usually I keep only 15 in my group, in teaching group as well, because I try to give one-to-one approach and I believe in that kind of a thing, that if I, you know, I don't want to be selfish and gather hundreds of people in one session or in one course, and then I'm not even able to deal with them. You can ask my doctors, my previous doctors whom I have teach, that I answer everybody. I absolutely answer everybody. Even today, if they send me, if they are revising and they are repeating something, I answer their queries. Exactly, that's something that you are trying to show to the examiner, that I am coming on to the level of the student. Okay. That's why you're asking her that, how much do you know? How much do you know? Now, doctors, why I'm explaining, I may sound over elaborative, but this is only because if I tell you these things, if I give you logic for everything, then you will remember that I am supposed to do this way because that's the logic behind it. Okay. So you will ask her that, how much do you know, so that I can begin from that point. Okay. So that we can start from that point onwards. See, you have already told her that ECG is a vast topic. And now you are telling her that, how much do you know, so that we can begin from there. Okay. We can begin from there. All right, doctors. So then, step in ECG teaching station is that you will ask her that, you have asked her that, how much do you know about ECG? Well, doctor, it's like a heart racing. That's what I know. Well, doctor, you know, they will pretend dumb. Okay. They will pretend dumb. They will not, in any teaching station, they will just pretend dumb so that you can teach. Okay. Now, if she has told you half of the definition, then you appreciate her. You will say, well done, Elena. And then you will tell her the complete definition of ECG. Okay. You'll say, yes, Elena, you are right. You are almost right. And very well done. Then you will say that it is an electrical activity of the heart. It is the electrical activity of the heart traced on a paper by ECG machine. Okay. By ECG machine. It is an electrical activity of the heart that is traced on a paper by ECG machine. So that is what I have written the definition here, doctors, for your convenience. All right. Okay. Now, doctors, the next step. Next step is that you will ask her, are you aware, Elena, are you aware of the conduction system of the heart? See, you are beginning like literally from zero. Okay. That's the kind of teacher they want you to be. Okay. That you check that how much knowledge other person has. If she says that, I know, doctor, I know the electrical conduction system of the heart. Okay. I know the conduction system of the heart, that no need to teach her. Okay. No need to teach her. But if she is not aware, then what you will do? You will do something that I'm going to share in next slide. Okay. So you will draw these two pictures. Okay. You will draw these two pictures side by side. Okay. This one and this one. All right. First, ask her, are you aware of the conduction system of the heart? Elena, may I know if you're aware of the conduction system of the heart? Okay, Elena will usually say, no, doctor. Okay, because I told you they will pretend dumb. Okay, they will pretend dumb. And don't forget, they are not doctors. Simulators are not doctors. They are only actors. Okay. So then doctors, you will draw. Doctors, now please, can I request you to practice drawing these two diagrams very well? You might even draw better than me. I'm not so good at drawing. Okay. But what I mean to say that don't leave it to the last minute and don't think that I will practice this in exam. Please, this exam, you spend lots of money, lots of effort, lots of emotional trauma. Please, you go through lots and lots of things. Please don't take any risks. Okay. So can I please request you to just practice these two diagrams. Okay. You might be very good at it, but when you go to the exam, your hand might be shaking. So make it anything what you are doing. I always tell my doctors, your knowledge for PLAPT exam has to be flawless. It has to flow. It has to be something that is second to your nature. It should flow in a way that you are a doctor who's been working in NHS in the last 1-2 years. That's the kind of skills they are looking for. Okay. So that your knowledge is flawless and it's just flowing. Okay. You don't have to think about things. So just like that, please have a pen and paper and practice these two. Okay, practice these two. Now, how you will be teaching? How you will be teaching her? You will say to her that there is, if she knows already, she knows that what is SA node, AV node, then no need to explain to her. Okay, so you will, if she does not know, okay, okay, Dr. Rahul, is it a compliment? I take it a compliment. I mean, if it is a compliment, I take it and thank you so much. All right. So I can be a good speaker. Am I not a good teacher then, Dr. Rahul? All right. Okay. All right. Thank you, Dr. Rahul. Thank you. I was just joking. All right. Okay. So then you will start with teaching her. Well, Dr. Tathir is here from our first batch. And they are very, very, very close to me, my first batch. And she's here. Thank you, Dr. Tathir. And I've been missing you. Let me tell you this. Okay. Right. Okay, doctors, let's come back. So SA node, doctors, so you will tell her that first of all, the electrical impulse in the heart starts from SA node, okay? Or you can say sinoatrial node. The impulse starts from here. Doctors, you might be thinking that what the hell Dr. Asia is doing? She's teaching us the physiology, medical school, second year, first lecture. Doctors, this is what a nurse, this is how much. She's not a doctor. She's not a cardiologist. This is from where she has to start learning from. Okay. So you will tell her that the electrical impulse in the heart starts from SA node and then it follows. Okay. Then it follows down to, or it comes down to AV node. Okay. It comes down to AV node. Now this much you can tell her that while SA node is passing to AV node, now this causes what? This causes atria to contract. Okay. This causes atria to contract. All right. So as a result of that contraction, you see P wave. When the atria contracts, you see P wave on your ECG. Okay. On ECG, you see P wave. Okay. Then you will tell her the waves come down, okay? The electrical impulse come down to the rest of the heart, okay? To the rest of the heart through Purkinje fibers. They are special muscles or special fibers. They are called Purkinje fibers and they run through the heart from the middle to the side, you can even say, okay? No need to give her so much detail. Just say they run through the muscles of the heart and then the ventricles contract, okay, then the ventricles contract. And the ventricular contraction shows as QRS wave on ECG. Okay, so you have told her the first impulse runs and what happens? You see a P wave on ECG. Then the impulse, the electrical impulse comes down to the ventricles contract, and on ECG, what do you see? You see a QRS wave. And then when the ventricles relax, you see a T wave. Okay, you see a T wave. Now at this point, usually during my lecture, I stop and I ask my doctors in the class that, now do you know that where is the atrial relaxation gone? The atrial relaxation, doctors, is actually hidden. Okay, atrial relaxation, we said there is a wave about atrial contraction, which is P wave. There is a wave, okay, there are waves for ventricular contraction, and those are QRS complex, and there is a wave for ventricular relaxation. So ventricular relaxation, that is T wave. Yes, doctor, you are absolutely right. Let me see what the doctor is writing. Yes, doctor. Dr. Maniza, very well done. You are right. Okay. Yes, it is hidden in the atrial relaxation is hidden in ventricular, okay, in QRS complex. Okay. So while atria were contracting, ventricles were contracting, what was happening? Atria was relaxing. So it is because these are such big waves, QRS complex is such a big wave that it hides the wave of atrial relaxation. Okay, atrial relaxation. Okay, so doctors, this contraction, when you are telling her contraction, you can use another word at that time. You will say that we will call it, when atria is contracting, we also call it atrial depolarization. When ventricles are contracting, we can also call it as ventricular depolarization. And when ventricular are relaxing, we call it ventricular repolarization. Okay, repolarization, relaxation, repolarization. Okay, all right. Then, doctors, you have taught her the basic waves. Okay, yeah, you have taught her the basic waves. All right, now is the next step. Come to heart rate. Okay, come to heart rate. Now, doctors, when you initially asked her that, what do you want? Is there anything in particular you want to learn in ECG? Initially, when you just started teaching her, she will say that, yes, doctor, actually, I want to learn heart rate. Almost always. I have about 10 friends who have faced ECG in their exam, this station. And when I spoke to them, they said, yes, doctor. Every time she said that she wants to learn heart rate. Okay. She always is keen to learn heart rate. Okay. So first of all, the first thing first, what you want to teach her? Something that she came to learn today, right? Something that she came to learn. Okay. So your first priority should be that. So now that she knows about the waves, now teach her that, Elena, do you know what is the normal heart rate? Okay. Well, yes, doctor, it is so much. And because I am explaining, if you practice this station with me, I will tell you that, you know, you can almost finish in 8 minutes, but because I'm elaborating everything, so you are feeling, trust me, when you are actually talking to a friend or you are practicing this station with a friend, it is manageable. Okay. It is manageable. It is, teaching stations are always the most challenging one, and you should practice them the most, doctors. And most of them, I will not, I will not lie to you, especially the respiratory teaching station, doctors. I asked everybody and no one ever finishes, okay? I had that in my exam as well, and I was not able to finish, but I got 11. In respiratory teaching examination. Okay. Okay. Yes, doctor. Yes. Okay. Let's go through this whole station. We don't want to, don't get a summary. Don't, you shouldn't be wanting to learn a summary even before you have gone through the station, doctors. Also, there is, you will, one thing I am teaching the much more shorter version. Academies teach you to become a cardiologist. Okay. So you will feel even more challenging or more overwhelmed. This is much more shorter form that I'm teaching you. But because I'm elaborating and I'm teaching, that's why you're feeling that it's a lot. Okay. So at this point, doctors, you will tell her, ask her, Elena, do you know what is the normal heart rate? And she will tell you, she will usually know this at least. Okay. She will not sound dumb at this point. And she will say that this is the heart rate and you will appreciate her. Well done, Elena. And then you will say, yes, that's right. And you will tell her now that, yes, if it is below 60, that is usually not normal. Okay. That is usually not normal. And it's called bradycardia. Okay. It is called, we call it bradycardia. All right. So inform a senior. Doctors, please. I have, by mistake, I've written here inferior senior. That's not what I meant to write. Okay. So doctors, then you will tell her that if it is low, okay, if the heart rate is low, which is below, when it is below 60, it, we call it bradycardia. And when it is more than 100, it is called tachycardia. Now, both of these conditions are not normal. Okay, are not normal. And if you see any patient in such condition, you should always seek a doctor. Okay. You should always look for a doctor and let them know. Okay. Because she is a nurse. So you're telling her that if such thing happen, you'll always look for a doctor and you will let them know. Okay. So now you have told her two things about heart rate. All right. Now teach her how to actually, how you will actually calculate the heart rate. Okay. Next slide. All right. So how will you calculate the heart rate? That's what she wants to learn and you will teach her now. So you will say that, let's see, Elena, how to calculate a heart rate. Now, you will say that first we check, Elena, first of all, we always check that if the heart rate is regular or irregular. Okay. If the heart rate is regular or irregular. Okay. And you will show her the paper method. Now, doctors, she is usually holding 2-3 ECG strips. Okay. You should take at least one ECG strip from her hand. Okay. You'll say that, Elena, can I have these ECG strips? And then you will take one strip and you will teach her the paper method. Okay. You will teach her to how to know. Elena, now I will tell you, how do we know if the heart rate is regular or not regular? Okay, so literally, doctors, when I teach my doctors in the course, I even move the paper and I teach them that we, with the paper, what do? We put a paper on top of the one of the ECG strip that we have taken from her. Okay, and then we move the paper. Okay, now, first of all, what you will do, you will, between the two R waves, okay, the distance between the two R waves. Now, what you will do, you will take a paper and you will line, okay, you will mark on the white paper the distance between the two R waves. So for example, there's an R wave, one R wave, and there's another R wave. And you will take a plain paper and you will mark on it with a pen. Okay. Doctors, by the way, if you are wondering, there will be a pen and paper in this station. Yes. I always tell my doctors that please keep your eyes and your ears open and look for the things they are given to you in the cubicle, because those things are not useless. Okay. Something if they want to provide you, that is there for a purpose. Okay. They want you to use it. So please don't ignore anything provided to you in the cubicle. In some of the cubicles, you will be provided, there will be a pen and paper on the table. So please don't ignore that. Okay. Now, most of you would have understood that, you know, what I meant by moving a paper. Now, putting the white paper on top of a normal ECG strip, okay? And then just putting two points, okay? Two points on where the two R waves are. Okay, if any of you is unclear at the end, doctors, I can even teach you the paper method. Doctors, you can tell her that. You can tell her that we always, whenever Alina, whenever we are teaching an ECG, we make, or whenever we are looking at an ECG, we always look at patient's name and date of birth. Okay, so you will show to the examiner that you are a safe doctor. Yes, Dr. Sadaf, you can do that as well. Okay, you can do that, and that is just showing that you are a safe doctor. You are just showing to the examiner an extra skill. Okay, it is not necessarily needed, but if you want to do it, yes, go ahead and do it. You are just getting some extra point by doing that. Okay. So then if the heart rate is regular, okay, if the heart rate is regular, what you will say to her that we do the formula that we use is 300 divided by number of large boxes, number of big boxes or number of large boxes between two R waves. Okay, between two R waves. You'll give her this formula and you will say, now look, Alina, here we have, for example, we have five boxes or four boxes. And then you will do the, for her, okay, you will divide it. You'll divide 300 divided by four or 300 divided by five. Okay, so if it is five boxes, for example, if there are five boxes, then 60, right? 60 will be the heart rate. And if there are four boxes, then also, you know, right? So now you have told her what is, if the heart rate is irregular, okay? Now you will tell her that, Alina, if the R waves, if the R wave, the distance between the R waves, it is not equal, that will mean that heart rate is irregular. Okay, heart rate is irregular. Now for this we will use a 6-minute ECG, sorry, 6-second ECG strip. Okay, for this method we use 6-second ECG strip, and we will count number of R waves in a 6-second strip. Okay, in a 6-second strip we will count how many R waves are there. And now for her, you will count. Now suppose, Alina, that in this case, if in this ECG, we did not have the heart rate regular and it was irregular, then we will count how many R waves are there and we will multiply the R waves to 10. Okay, multiply the number of R waves into 10. All right. So you have told her, doctors, irregular heart rate and regular heart rate, how to calculate this. Okay. Now the next thing you should aim to teach her should be rhythm. Okay. Should be rhythm. Now rhythm is very easy, doctors. You will tell her that, Alina, every P wave in an ECG, when we are looking at a normal ECG, every P wave should be followed by QRS complex. Okay, every P wave should be followed by a QRS complex, and a QRS complex should be followed by T wave. That's a normal rhythm of the heart. That's a normal rhythm of the heart. If any of these waves have any abnormality, then that means that rhythm of the heart is not normal. Okay, the rhythm of the heart is not normal. At this point, you can even give her the example of heart blocks. Okay, you can give her example of heart blocks. You will say that at any point when I told you the conduction system of the heart, if the electrical impulse is not able to pass because of any abnormality in the heart or any heart blocks, that will lead to abnormal rhythm. Okay, that will lead to abnormal rhythm, and you have to inform the senior. Okay, you have to inform the senior if the rhythm is not normal. Okay, now doctors, you can even tell her that, Alina, there are some abnormal ECGs. For example, the most common ones are ST elevation. Now, if they, she has any ST elevation ECG, just with the pen, point out quickly and say that this is the ST elevation, Elena. And if that's the case, please, if there is an ST elevation, please inform your senior. Now, in this case, patient will have what? Patient will have a shortness of breath, chest pain. Okay, patient will have breathing difficulty, or you will say patient will have, you can, by the way, you can use medical jargons when you are talking to a medical professional in your PLAPRO exam. Okay, if you are talking to a nurse or a doctor, you can always, always, doctors, you can always use medical jargons, no problem in that. While you are talking to a patient, then only you have to be used that constipated language of layman. Okay, so you always have to over-explain things or put them in a simple language. Otherwise, talking to medical professionals, you don't have to worry about that. Okay? So you will, at the end, if it is possible, tell her about ST elevation at least, and tell her that how to manage that patient. If a patient is having shortness of breath, chest pain, patient is sweating, then you will do what? You will have to, Elena, you will inform your senior. That will mean that if this patient is having heart attack or this patient is having MI. So you should inform your senior right away. Okay. You should inform your senior right away. Okay. If you still have time, you can tell her that you should start the oxygen and you should go and inform your senior, inform a doctor because we'll need to give her some analgesia. Okay. Need to give him some analgesia right away and we need to manage the patient right away. Okay. Start the oxygen and go and find your doctor. Okay. That's the safety netting, doctors, that at the end when I told you. Every station, I think by now, most of you will know that in order to pass, what the academies never used to tell, now most of the doctors, they know. But still, if any one of you do not know, that safety netting is a very important part. If you even, you know, please try to spend less time on your data gathering. Manage your time well while you are practicing so that you can save some time for safety netting. That will increase your chances of passing every station if you are doing safety netting in every station. All right, doctors. So that was it for today. And I am looking forward to help you guys, you doctors, every now and then. I will see if during the course as well, if I can try I will try my best to help you doctors. But from Monday, we are starting our new course. So yes, course is starting from Monday. And any one of you doctors, if you would like to attend even for one day, I have told in the group, you can choose to attend even one day if you are not keen to attend the whole course. So you are more than welcome at any day if you want to join, let me know. And okay. So that's it for now. If any one of you is keen to booking mocks as well, please let me know. I do have space at the moment. I am actually beginning the mocks from Monday as well. So morning I will be doing at least one mock with some doctors, and I will be doing in the evenings, I will be doing the class. Okay, rest of the days for my family. So that's it, doctors. Any one of you has any questions, any queries? Let me see. Well, doctors, for now, I am keeping 10 stations, okay, because I want to give you a feel of the real exam, okay? But if you choose to reduce the stations, I'll reduce the price, okay? If you choose that, you know, I'm not comfortable, doctor, with such a long mock, then I'll reduce the station. If I spend less time with you for the mock, I'll charge you less. Okay. That's how straightforward it is. Okay. If you want to, doctors, if there are 10 stations that I am, and doctors, I don't take mock like Academy, or I don't take mock like other doctors online. It'll be like teaching you those 10 stations because I'll be giving you feedback and I will also be telling you that how to improve those stations. What are the mistakes that doctors make and what are the tips to improve yourself? Okay. Yeah.
All right. So okay. Right. Okay, doctors. Yeah. Yes, doctors. Somebody will always be rude there. So I don't mind that. So doctors, take care, and I shall see you soon. Okay. Right. Anyone has any other questions? Thank you, doctor. Thank you. Thank you. I know there'll be people who will not be appreciative of anybody, and they will still join the sessions. If they are saying that everybody teaches the same thing, then why do you go to their sessions? Don't come to the sessions, right? Thank you, doctor. Thank you. All right. No, I'm not listening to anybody. I'm a very positive person, and yes. Alhamdulillah, I look at positive sides of life always. I like to look at life like that. Okay. Yes, doctors, Alhamdulillah. Okay, doctors, you take care. And again, I would repeat myself. Okay. Yes, detail of mocks, doctors. Please message me. I hope that most of you have my number and you are my part of my group. If you are not, okay, I'll share my number here then. Some of the. Okay, doctors, I'll share my number here because some of you are asking the number. Okay, so the. Well, yes, doctor, you can touch upon MI. Just touching it and telling her that, if the patient comes with these symptoms and he has this ST elevation, literally, if I was you, I would hold that ECG strip in my hand and I would just label. I will just label, or I would just draw on ST elevation. She will definitely have one strip, which is ST elevation. So I would, circle on that. Okay. I would circle on that and I would say to her that this is ST elevation. And if this is a patient's ECG, that patient will have symptoms of shortness of breath, chest pain. Okay, those kind of things. And then you will say that she, as a nurse, she shouldn't do much. As a nurse, the management that most management she can do, if patient is having breathing difficulty, she should just start the oxygen, call a doctor right away. Okay. Okay, doctors, I will help you, doctors, on sick note. Changing counselor, doctors, that station I got 11, so definitely I will help you with changing counselor and counseling that changing the counselor station and sick note. No problem, doctors. Next, those will be on the list. Okay. Now I hope that I have sent the doctors have got my number. Okay, doctors. Okay, doctors. We'll do one by one. Okay, we'll do one by one. While please stay patient in the group, okay, and stay there. I will try to do free sessions as well in between the course, but please bear with me because I have family and I will be starting the course. During the course, it gets very overwhelming. Okay, so don't worry. Okay, doctors, take care. And I shall see you soon. Okay, you're very welcome, doctors. You are very welcome. Take care. All right.